The Lord hears the cry of the poor. Blessed be the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times, with praise ever in my mouth. Let my soul glory in the Lord, who will hear the cry of the poor. The Lord hears the cry of the poor. Blessed be the Lord.
Welcome to your cathedral. I'm Father Greg Sackowitz. Special thank you again and again to Mark Teresi and David Jonas for providing beautiful music as a way to intro and finish and bring to a conclusion the spiritual videotape. Also, special thank you to Father Mark, producer Smolka, who does such a great job week in and week out. And I think, Mark, if I'm not mistaken, this is around our 65th taping for these spiritual videos, which is unbelievable. It's well over a year. And thank you for all those who've been watching weekly, so thank you. I might have told this joke before. I lose track of the jokes that I tell. If you heard it, laugh anyway. Humor me. A man was going to a very important meeting, but he could not find a parking space. The frustrated driver finally leaned on divine intervention and said a very quick prayer. He said, "Lord, please take pity on me. If you find me a parking space, I promise I will tithe and go to Mass every Sunday the rest of my life. I'll also give up smoking." Right then, a parking space appeared. The driver looked up to heaven and said, "Never mind, Lord, I found one." I like that one. How many times under stress or pressure have we said, "Oh God, if you do this, or if I do that, I'll change. I promise." Then the little or big storm clears and the sky is once again very sunny. We go back to our former ways and self. Think about the following. All of us have two selves. We have an external, task-oriented self that is used to getting jobs done. We have an internal, more reflective self that is very thoughtful. Which of those two selves wakes up quicker in the morning? Our external, task-oriented self, or our internal, reflective self? More than likely, it's our external, task-oriented self. I know in my life, I start my to-do list the minute I start getting up in the morning. But now, think about this. A little kind of a different way of looking at the whole thing. What happens when we wake up in the morning? The alarm clock goes off. Have you ever thought about the phrase alarm clock? What an awful, awful concept. Why isn't it called an opportunity clock? Or it's going to be a great day clock? Or good morning God clock? The alarm immediately ignites our task-oriented self and we jump out of bed. Pretty soon, we're trying to eat breakfast while checking emails and washing. We race to the car, pick up the cell phone, and rush off to meetings all morning, followed by meetings, lunch, after lunch, in the afternoon, sometimes even a dinner meeting. Even with COVID, how many of us have spent hours and hours this past 15 months not at the meeting itself, but a Zoom meeting, one Zoom meeting right after another. And by 8, 9, or 10 p.m., we fall into bed exhausted without any energy to say goodnight to anybody who might be around. What happens the next day? The alarm clock goes off and we're at it again. Pretty soon, our life becomes a rat race. As Lily Tomlin once said, the problem with a rat race is even if you win the race, you're still a rat. Now, what is interesting about today's gospel, this 13th week in ordinary time, this last full weekend in June, first full week of summer, is that it can sometimes lead us to believe this only tells us something about Jesus, but the gospel doesn't. The truth is, it also tells us something about ourselves. Let me explain. Life happens. Life happens. The joys and tragedies of our lives can be teachers if we are willing to listen and be transformed with the help and grace of God. So even in a time of tragedy, can we be transformed by that to new life and new beginnings? Jim Ivers was my junior prefect in the college seminary, in Niles College Seminary of Loyola University. I was a freshman. He was my junior prefect as a college freshman, 71, 72 of the years. Jim was a great, great athlete. We played football, softball, and a lot of basketball together until December 9th, 2005. Jim was the director of a retreat house in Woodstock, Illinois. He was never ordained a priest and was happily married with three children. On December 9th, 2005, everything changed. Jim was shoveling snow off his driveway. All of a sudden, a woman comes barreling down the street on the slick road with ice on it and snow, totally out of control, and the car slams right directly into Jim. Both his legs were broken, and Jim's face slammed through the front windshield, permanently leaving him blinded for life. Jim spent 4 months in the hospital rehabbing with many, many surgeries to his face, his eyes, and his legs. I only found out about this terrible tragedy in about June of 2006. I gave Jim a call at his house. I hadn't spoken with him in a couple of years, but I have wonderful memories of our time together in the college seminary for the Archdiocese of Chicago. Jim was very, very happy to hear from me. He always had a terrific sense of humor, loved a good joke, and kept a positive attitude toward life, even now after the tragedy. Jim said the impact to his head did leave him permanently blinded the rest of his life, which so saddened me. As we talked and shared on the phone, Jim shared three things that I actually had to write down that left me almost in tears. Jim said this: number one, I'm now starting to see life differently. I'm starting to see life differently. He's blind. Number two, my entire life I was filled with independence and proud of my independence, but now I am independence totally upon others. He said, I've gone from independence to total independence upon others and God. And lastly, with the help and grace of God, I hope to be transformed and changed from sight to insight. To be changed and transformed from sight to insight about life. I hope to be able to be light for others. I never want anyone to feel sorry for me. And despite being in dependence upon God and others, I want to be joy-filled and move forward. I have to admit, after about a half hour, I hung up the phone with Jim, was so moved by his comments. He wasn't just trying to give me lip service. I could tell he was living it, about seeing life differently, about independence upon others and God, having been so independent. And thirdly, to go from sight to insight. I thought to myself, the Lord Jesus was speaking through him to touch him despite the tragedy he'd experienced in December of 05. With grace and wisdom, may we let the divinity that exists within us, God who's within us, change our hearts, enabling us to transform despair into hope, sadness into joy, anguish into healing, estrangement into community, lemons into lemonade, and hardened hearts to compassion, forgiveness, and mercy. It's easily said, but hard to do, and something we can't do without the help and grace of God. Jairus, in today's gospel, is a desperate man and in a desperate attempt to save his beloved daughter, does not hesitate to risk his standing in the community and career to approach the controversial rabbi, Jesus, and ask him to please help. Imitating the compassion and forgiveness of Jesus, may we realize the possibilities for healing, resurrection, and change in our own lives and the lives of others. You know, the people who make a difference in our lives are not the ones with the greatest credentials, the most money, or the most toys. Instead, the people who make the most difference in our lives, they're the ones who truly care. Live in such a way that those who know you but do not know God will come to know God because they know you. Live in such a way that those who know you but do not know God will come to know God because they know you. May God bless all of you. Enjoy summer. Safe travels. May the White Sox, even the Cubs, keep winning or begin winning again. Amen.
Blessed are you poor, for the kingdom shall be theirs. Blessed are you that weep and mourn, for one day you shall laugh. And if wicked tongues insult and hate you, all because of me. Blessed, blessed.